Thank you all. Thanks for bearing with us there through our technology issues. It always happens on Zoom, so apologies on that. I'm Jim Burnham, an adult services librarian at the Pittsford Community Library. I'm joined this evening by my co-host librarians, Peggy O'Neill and Susan Del Pazzo of respectively the Penfield Public Library and the Webster Public Library. We're so excited that you all could join us this evening for In This Moment, Unlocking Classical Music. Before we hand it off to tonight's presenter, Herb Smith, guest conductor and third trumpet of the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra, a quick word about the In This Moment project. Tonight is one of a series of events highlighting participants of In This Moment, Revolution, Reckoning, Reparation. In This Moment is a local project that teamed Black writers and photographers to profile 10 Black leaders from across the city of Rochester. Each profile is being published as a chapbook by the Visual Studies Workshop. The project demonstrates the breadth and scope of revolutionary work happening here in the Rochester area. Several area libraries, including the three host libraries, are giving away copies of the chapbooks as they are published, and you can also purchase them from the VSW. Finally, we also wanted to thank the friends of each of our libraries for support of programs like these. So a big thank you to them, and thanks to everyone who's attending tonight. And without further ado, please take it away, Herb.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Herb.
It's a pleasure for me to be here today. And let's have some little fun and talk about classical music. I'm going to start it off by playing a little bit. In case you don't know, I am a trumpet player, and I think that's me right there. And I think that's me. Is that me? Yeah, that's me. I'm going to play you a little piece just to get us started off. This is an etude by a French composer whose name is Sabarich, and it's just an etude is a piece that is written to practice and to further your skill as a musician. And some of those pieces that are written are just really beautiful pieces. I think they're outright pieces in their own. And so this is Sabarich, Anton Sabarich, number 8. Here we go. Thank you for applause. I can't hear any applause at all, but I'm assuming I can see some hands moving, so that's good. Good. This topic, unlocking classical music, is fun. One of the things for me, I have kind of a broad knowledge of music. I played a lot of different types. You know, I went to school at Eastman, and played in the Eastman orchestras there. At the same time I was at Eastman in the orchestras, I was in the jazz ensembles, and I played with our RPO right now. I played with the Buffalo Philharmonic, played with a lot of different orchestras, but at the same time I was doing that, I was also playing the Four Tops, Gladys Knight and the Pips, Aretha Franklin, the OJs, and playing shows, Wicked and Pippin. So I have kind of I played in a reggae band. I played in a klezmer band. So there's just a lot of different types of music that I play in. And I think it kind of gives me a bit of a perspective on different types of music that can kind of open them up. So before we start talking about classical music, what is classical music? Anyone want to throw something in the chat? Kind of tell me what they might think classical music is. What is classical music? What is classical music? Classical music, it's interesting because classical music isn't something that it was like, and now we are going to create classical music. It was something that they put on music, and they called it it was actually for a specific time period in music. It was like the time around Beethoven, Haydn, Mozart. It was specifically called that. Nowadays, classical music is just kind of one bag. You know, it's kind of one thing. Like, I'm going to see a classical concert at the RPO. You know, it's like, and that includes a lot of different types of music, you know. So it's kind of a term, classical, and I think a lot of people have their own kind of misconceptions about what classical is. I mean, a lot of people feel that classical music is something that's European. That's not necessarily the case. There have been African-American and Black composers since the beginning. Chevalier de Saint George was a composer right around the same time as Mozart. As a matter of fact, those two composers, and he was a Black man, those two composers lived in the same, I believe they lived in the same area, the same town. And people a lot of times say that St. George is the Black Mozart, but it actually might be that Mozart is the white St. George because they were right around the same time period. Something you hear on Classical 91.5. Yes, right, classical music, right, exactly. Music written by people who are dead, that's fantastic. That's not true, though. There are some live, living, heart still beating composers, classical composers out there. So before I kind of get into a little bit about classical music, I'm just going to give you some examples, and we'll kind of talk about it and kind of get underneath the meaning of classical music. So to start this off, I'm going to share my screen here really quickly. Let's see here. Yeah. Okay, share screen, and I want to share sound as well. Very good. Optimize for video clip. Very good. And okay, so let's play this song here in order to talk about classical music.
The name of the dance is called the butt. It's called the butt. Playback! Ernest, we gotta go down this way, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Doing the butt. How is doing the butt going to explain classical music? Right? Okay. This song was specifically written for a dance, a specific dance. In this case, the dance is the butt. This is a Spike Lee movie. It's from an older Spike Lee movie called School Days. Now, let's listen to another example of a song written specifically for a dance. Okay, so two songs written specifically for dances. What's the difference? Really, no difference other than age. No difference. Back in the day, the waltz was the craze, was the thing that you did. You went out, you danced the waltz. You know, you partied. You probably drank some mead or some beer, some wine, and you danced, right? You didn't go to the club. You listened to the orchestra play some waltz. And it's the exact same thing. And in this case, it's even a closer correlation because Tchaikovsky wrote this piece for a specific work. Right? A specific dance. That piece, The Butt, was written for a specific work. Right? It's just a difference in time. Right? And it's a difference in language. It's also a difference in, you could say, technology. Right? Because, you know, they didn't have electronics and stuff back then. So it was, your entertainment was classical music. That's how you had fun. So Spike Lee actually created that song for that specific dance. And this, the waltz before Tchaikovsky, is the exact same thing. And it was one of those things like, are you going out waltzing? You better not be going out waltzing. No, no, that's not a thing. You need to be at home, you know, memorizing your Bible scriptures. I don't know what they did back then, but it was taboo. Right, it was taboo. So it's kind of like once you get underneath classical music and find its original purpose, its original expression, that helps you to kind of unlock it. A lot of people just, that classical music, right? And just with my history of like just playing all kinds of different classical music, and believe me, there's some classical music I don't like for sure. I have been on stage and I've been like, I cannot wait until this piece is over. I am tired of this piece. So there's a lots of different types of classical music as well. But in this case, dance. Classical music was dance music. All right. Now, let's go to a different example of kind of the purpose, the underlying meaning of classical music. I'm going to share my screen and I'm going to go here. All right, let's watch a little bit of this.
Lord Weaver.
I was wondering if you might do me the honor of a dance tonight.
Must I share your attention with every moonlight dandy, Miss Bridgerton?
Only the charming ones, Your Grace. Jealousy.
Okay, my internet is messing up here.
Well done. Someone is angling for a promotion in rank. So, tell me, my lord, do you prefer the city or the country?
I suppose I've never thought of it.
I am partial to the country. But there are certainly advantages to both. Where do you see yourself settling?
Another excellent question.
You look bewitching tonight, Miss Bridgerton.
Well, I do hope you are not too spellbound to chat, Lord Hardy.
Did you know I purchased my first Landau when I left Oxford?
Okay, my internet's not working as well as I'd like, but have any of you ever watched much of Bridgerton? Yes, probably have. Def Leppard wasn't considered classic rock when I was a teenager. It's fun. Bridgerton, right? So how is Bridgerton? I mean, that's kind of a connection. You can hear the classical music in the background. But I'm using Bridgerton because it was a very popular series. Lots of gossip, and love, and sex, and killing, and all that good stuff, right, that we love to watch on TV. When we want to watch that, what do? Pull out Netflix, pull out Hulu, pull out, Amazon Prime, Disney Plus. There's a lot of different places you can get your fix on some gossip, on some series, on some soaps. Right? Back in the day, my mom used to watch As the World Turns. I think Lisa, one of the characters, got married like 15 times or something like that. It was pretty awesome. But, so what did you do back? What did you do back in the day? You didn't have Netflix. You didn't have Amazon Prime. Let's watch this. Let's see if I can share my screen again.
Must pass the hour.
Grace Bunbury. Wow, fantastic voice. The Scandal. I mean, Carmen. Harlot. Gossip. Sex. Relationships. Killing. Violence. It's all in opera. And for me, like when I have a good series on Netflix and I'm watching it or whatever, or a show, when you get to that last episode, you're like, ah, I want more, right? That's how opera is. Like when people, you go to an opera, you're like, oh my God, this opera is 3 hours long. I can't take it. Well, for them, that was fun. That was soap. That was all they had. And composers like Wagner, he wrote like Tannhäuser. I went to Tannhäuser in New York City. And first of all, I got there an hour late to the opera, because the opera is three acts, and each act, I believe, is like 2 hours long. It takes like 6 hours to do the whole thing. So I figured I'd get there an hour late so I could, you know, not fall asleep or whatever. As I'm going to, I was in New York City. As I'm going there, I see the trumpet players walking towards me. I'm like, what are you guys doing? He says, oh yeah, we have a 40-minute break in the middle of the piece. So we figured we'd go to the bar and have a beer, quick beer. I'm like, what? So Wagner wrote these long operas because people wanted to be entertained. You know, you want to hear about that. You want to kind of have an escape. You want to enjoy that. So that's kind of where opera came from. That's why opera is so long. Like, oh God, it's so long. That's what it is. It's a soap. It's fun. You know, so having that awareness of when it was created helps you to get inside of the music. It really does. If we took one of our pop songs now and went back in time and played it, they would be like, what is this? Like, they would have no clue. And that's really what's going on with classical music. Again, there are composers composing today, but they're composing based on a model that is, it's an older model. It's an older time. And so having that awareness just allows you to kind of go, okay, I get it now. I kind of have, you have to shift gears. You know, you have to really shift gears. The other thing here that I always think about is, like, today, kids, what do they do most of the time? Like, most of the time, like, my little buddies, they're playing video games. They play video games just all day long. They got screens, they got phones, they got iPads, you got, you know, 100-inch TV, whatever. They're playing those video games. Years and years ago, we didn't have that. Everyone played an instrument. I'm actually actively trying to bring that back. Really do feel like everyone should play an instrument. But everyone played an instrument. Everyone took lessons. You learned music. That was something that you did. Like, you were bored, you played an instrument. You learned piano. Many instances where you would go to someone's house and they would say, okay, would you play a piece for us? Can you come on out here and play a piece for us? So people, they would play, the kids would play a piece, or the, you know, the father or someone would play for the guests. That was a part of the culture. So then the whole family, the whole neighborhood, the whole city had that common language of music, of playing an instrument. And then now you go to a concert, an opera. So classical music had the tie to your everyday life was much more connected than it is now. Nowadays, where do you hear music? Where do you hear classical music? You know, you hear it at a concert. You hear it Bridgerton, right? You hear it cartoons. Like, a lot of cartoons have it, and you hear it in movie soundtracks. You hear it in movie soundtracks. And basically the reason why you hear it in movie soundtracks is because the orchestra has so many different timbres and sounds and can really flex and flow with the with what's going on with the scene, with the emotions. It can really show different colors like no other group. And so having the strings, the bass, the trumpet every now and again coming in, that really, you know, it really does. I mean, one of my favorite soundtracks, and I'm kind of dating myself here, is Jaws. Da 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 da. It's like, what's getting ready to happen? You know, it's just, that's orchestra. Those are cellos doing that. Da, da. So it's really fantastic to kind of really get underneath classical music and really find out, you know, what was it there for? You know, what was the purpose of it? And what are some of the ways that it's used? Another thing, Revolution. Classical music has been used for revolution, to rouse the people up, to express yourselves for equality. It has been used like that since the very, very beginning. There is a great piece by, I want to say Haydn. I'm messing up my name. I think it's Haydn. It's called The Farewell Symphony. I believe it's Haydn. He was upset with the king. They were not getting wages the way they wanted to. So he wrote this piece. And the way he wrote the piece was, as the piece went, everyone was on stage. And then the trumpets finish, they leave the stage. The French horns finish, they leave the stage. Everyone left the stage until a violinist at the end. And he was basically saying, we're going on strike. We're leaving. You know, this is Haydn's time. You know, Shostakovich. He was just really, really upset with the communist regime. And so he wrote music that expressed that. Sibelius, Verdi, all these guys wrote music to express equality. They wanted equality. They wanted revolution. I'm going to play for you now. This is a little self-serving, but I'm going to play for you now a clip from RPO playing Aaron Copland's Fanfare for the Common Man, and we did this at a Black Lives Matter rally. I was the conductor, and the whole point of Fanfare for the Common Man is that right there, the common person. Aaron wrote this piece to bolster and to lift up the common people, not, you know, he felt like, you know, the rich were, you know, getting richer and the poor were getting poorer, and he wanted to express this in music, in solidarity, and he wrote this piece called Fanfare for the Common Man. And for RPO, we were able to play this piece at a Black Lives Matter rally. This was June 30th, 2020, so it was during the heavy part of the pandemic. And it was just a really great expression for me as a Black man to be conducting this piece in front of these people, but also for the organization to be able to support. One of the things that I always talk about is people always, you know, you want to support, but you're not sure how to support. To me, the best way to support is you support in the area that you do. So for me as a musician, then I am not going to go out and write some laws and stuff. Well, I could do that, but that's not my forte. My forte is music. So how can I use music to express that, to make change? And so that's what we did here with Fanfare for the Common Man, played at a Black Lives Matter rally. I'm going to show you a little bit of that. We are here doing what we do to support, and this will not be the last time we're here. Great. That was a really great moment to express that through music. And composers have been doing that since the beginning. And we hear a lot of these revolutionary classical songs, and they just, oh yeah, okay, right, that's Verdi. I love that opera. That's wonderful. But it's like, no, that was actually revolutionary, you know, how many years ago? So kind of having that, again, having that awareness of where the music came from, the context of it, really can help to open up the meaning and unlock classical music. Now, this brings to me the part, one of my favorite parts, and if you could unpin me a little bit, so I think I'm pinned, so I can see everyone. Can you do that? Okay, now she's pinned. I don't know.
I unspotted lighted you. It should, let's see.
Yeah, turn it to, gallery view. I got it, gallery view. That's what I want, gallery view. Got it. Okay, so now I'm gonna get out my handy dandy baton. And I'm going to ask each and one of you to pull out your baton. Oh, you don't have a baton? Well, grab a pencil. Baseball bat might be too heavy. Drumstick. A stick. What else? Anything? All right. And we're going to do a little conducting. And a lot of people are always asking, well, what does the conductor do? What is he up there doing? He's just waving his stick? Like, what's going on? So there are specific things that the conductor does. And kind of having an awareness of what the conductor is doing also will help you to kind of unlock classical music for you as well. So there's a specific, like a lot of songs are in four. And when I say four, musicians, you know what I'm talking about, but other people you may not. It's basically four beats, it's like groups of four. So like one, two, three, four. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, in 4. Most tunes are in 4. A lot of tunes are in 4. There are specific movements that you do for that a conductor does. So 1 is down. 2 is to your left. All right, I'm going to go opposite. Right, I think. 2 is to your left. Right? 3 is across. 3. And then 4 is up. And then back down to 1. I'll try to keep it. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Exactly. That's it. 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so based on how you're conducting it, like you can see this is more smooth. Like it would be more like a lyrical thing. Right? But if you were doing like a march, it would be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So let's see if we can pull up Star Spangled Banner. That'll be a good one. Let's see if we can do that, and then we can conduct to it. Star Spangled, there we go. Perfect. Yeah, so we're going to do this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here, I'm going to share my screen again here. All right. You know what? I don't like that one. Let's not do that one. Let's do Stars and Stripes Forever. That's better. Yeah, that's better. Good. Perfect. That's perfect. Right. So that's it. Now there's other beats. There's other patterns too. So there's a 3 pattern. Where 3 is 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Da da dum dum. Blip 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 blip. Bom ba da dum dum. Blip 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 blip. Blom ba da dee dee. Get wide with it. Bum 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 bum. Da 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 dee dee. Blum blum. Blum blum. Now faster. Bum 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 bum. 1, 2. Bum. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Great. Congrats. Good job. Really good job. It's good to see so many people conducting. That's fun. Yeah. So all of these things really help. I mean, there's so much more you can get into. To really get into the music of it, I'm kind of giving you just kind of a glossing over it, but there's so much to get into it. And for me, it really was important for me to delve into Black composers for me. It really was important for me because there is this feeling that classical music was this European thing, that there weren't a lot of Black players, Black composers, Black conductors. And that's really not true. These composers and conductors and players were marginalized. I am the only Black musician in the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra. And as a matter of fact, not only the only Black, but I am the first full-time musician in the They had a conductor, but in the history of the organization. So it was important for me to kind of just realize, okay, wow, Cavalier St. George was writing music back in the day. You know, wow. Like, there's so many, Ulysses K, Adolphus Hale Stork, all of these musicians, composers, conductors, you know, there's just so, the history of that, it goes back. In slavery, the slave owners would have slaves learn violin and play music for entertainment, you know. And so these were classical musicians. There were bands and orchestras of all Black musicians in the 1800s. It's fantastic. It's something that we don't hear a lot about. And to really delve into that and see that and know that this music is not just a European, white European thing. It's everybody. It belongs to everyone. It really does belong to everyone. And really getting into that really helped me to be able to really delve into it with a whole heart and really own it for myself. It took me many years to get to this place too. It's like when I was at Eastman, I wasn't taught this stuff. We weren't taught about Black composers. It was just something we weren't taught about. And so to really get into this, and now like there's this push for diversity, which I'm very happy to see, and we want to keep this going, and things like in this moment, this project where they had a Black leader and a Black photographer and a Black writer, these are all things that really help to further it. Are there any questions? Do we have any questions?
There is a question in the chat room. I think this is in reference to you talking about the fact that you're the only African-American musician in the RPO. And somebody asked, why do you think you're the only one?
Why do I think I'm the only one? Mm-hmm. Well, when I look around in the rehearsals, I don't see any others. No, I'm just kidding. I think that was funny. No. So this is the age old question right here. You know, it's what came first, the chicken or the egg? So there are Black classical musicians out there. There aren't as many, and so orchestras do have audition process. They have an audition process where a lot of orchestras have an audition process where it is behind a screen. They do not know who's playing. They don't know if it's male or female. Even with that, though, there's ways to you know, hand pick who you might want in an orchestra. Okay. And so there's that. So I think that there's some of that has been going on in orchestras. I really do feel that way. I know someone specifically who made it to all the way to the final round. She was a violinist, and then when they looked behind the screen and they saw who it was, they decided not to hire her. So there is a bit of that was going on many orchestras now are changing that. Many orchestras now are going through a change where they are reevaluating their audition process. I personally feel like an orchestra should reflect the city that it's in. It should reflect that, or at least try to reflect it. Rochester is 30% black. RPO is not 30% black. All right. Okay. Now, the other part here is to be a classical musician, there's a lot of training and study that needs to happen. Where does that start? It starts in fourth grade. It starts before that. Many city schools across the country, one of the first things they cut? Music. That's where you're going to throw that net to get the players to start them. So then now they're fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, working on their way up until they get to college. So there's a bit of that that needs to happen as well. It's not just a, you know, blanket thing. It's a problem that really needs to be worked on, but you got to kind of start, you know, not even at A. You got to go before A. You got to start before A and get to A and then move forward, you know. So it's a real problem. And I'm in a group called the Gateways Music Festival, which is an orchestra that is all African American players, and we'll be playing a concert here in Rochester in April, and then we're going from Rochester to Carnegie Hall. Everyone in that group is like the one or the two or the three in their prospective orchestras around the world, and then we come together and do a concert. So yeah, it's a real tricky thing, and I am working diligently so that I am the first but not the last and not the only in RPO. I hope I answered that question.
There's another question here. It says, how do you think classical music can increase its appeal to new, younger audiences? I'm going to speak really quickly on that, Herb, because I know that some of the stuff the RPO has been doing has been really fabulous. And one of the things they've done that I think really does appeal to younger audiences is doing these movies where you guys play the soundtrack. That is really cool. I've gone to a couple of those and it's really fabulous. It's a lot of young kids, a lot of teens in the audience. The RPO does a really good job of trying to pull those younger audiences in. So now you can talk. Sorry.
That's perfect. That's exactly right. The RPO, we are diligently working to connect with a younger audience. Again, it's a tough sell when you think about, okay, you know, we're going to ask you to come into a room, sit down, listen to a piece for 30 minutes. There's no visual other than the players playing. There's no real story happening, right? There's no, it's like you're getting just the music. Where in today's society, everything is, it's like a mixed bag. You have the music and the video going on at the same time, and it's what, 5 minutes or so, you know. So it's a thing. Now what I propose here is we have to educate the audience in a way so that they can, not because classical music is this great thing that you don't know about and we're going to tell you what you should know, but it's this thing where, okay, I want to show you, just like I did today, how classical music is the same as what you listen to. It's just maybe older. It's just kind of using different instruments. But you listen to a song about love, this song is about love, right? You like to watch shows. That's what this is. That's what this opera is. You listen to dance music. That's what this is, dance music. And these are kind of the ways that you can connect with people. But barring that, movies, kids love it, but we did Star Wars. We did the soundtrack to Star Wars, and I was a kid. I was loving it. I was just upset because I was behind the screen. I couldn't see the screen. I would have been great to be like, you know, and look up and see the things flying. I mean, that would have been just fantastic. So things like that. Also, video games use a lot of classical music. So we did a concert of video game music, and they had the big screens up, and we were playing, and they had the video games up there. And I remember after that concert, I went to Wegmans, and someone was like, "Did you play the concert tonight? That was awesome." I mean, people were really, I was recognized. I was like, "Oh, wow." Never get recognized after a concert like that. So it was, you know, those are definitely ways that the orchestra is trying to connect. But I really, that's my thing is how to connect with people. How to connect with people. How to show, basically, if you can show people that this is the same, then you can connect.
I was at that Star Wars and I had chills right from the opening 20th Century Fox credits. Oh, I couldn't believe it. Now I'm going to take my son to Jurassic Park in January. I think it is. I can't wait.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I'll be playing Jurassic Park.
So I saw that on the, you know, well, here it is on the flyer right here. And I'm so excited.
Yeah.
But I have a question. You mentioned before, you know, if you, talking about popular music today, and if they heard it back centuries ago, what they would think of it. Is there a piece of music, a song, or an album that you would send back, maybe not to blow their minds so much, but something that might connect, you know, I don't know?
That's a good question. I don't know. I haven't really thought about that. I mean, I bet you like some Beatles would be good, probably, because you got guitar, you know, which would be close to like a lute or something, you know, and it's singing. Some John Lennon would be good. Maybe some, I don't know. I was thinking like really driving crazy if you threw in some James Brown or something like that.
But he suggested Chuck Berry, so you're not too far off. Chuck Berry.
Yeah, that's a good, that would be like a good scene in like a Back to the Future 7 or something, you know?
I only ask, when my brother and I always debate this, if we could send a song up to space for the aliens, and my pick's always an album, Stevie Wonder, Songs in the Key of Life. I think that would well represent humanity, I think.
Yeah, that's good. That's a good one. Yes. I like that one. All right, any other questions? Wild Al Yankovic, for sure.
They would definitely wonder about us if we sent that up.
How does a composer's process work to write the scores for each different instrument in order to end up with the finished piece? One instrument's part at a time? Okay. All composers kind of do it differently. But I know, especially composers that compose classical music, a lot of times you hear the music and you feel the feeling of it, and you hear the sound of it. And if you work with an orchestra, then you automatically just start hearing, you know, da, 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 da. Okay, that's oboe right there, you know. Da, 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 da. Okay, that's strings doing that part. Because it's like a artist getting ready to paint the ocean. The artist knows, I'm going to use blue for that. I'm just going to use blue. I'm going to use white for the clouds. Okay, that boat's red. I'm going to use red. So when you're hearing all those sounds, you know, you start to hear all of the different instruments. You hear them. You know, the same way that you would look at a picture and see all the colors. You hear all of those colors, all of those sounds. I compose. I have a jazz trio that I play with called the Freedom Trio. And actually, a little plug for myself, we're playing at Parcel 5 downtown. I believe it's the 12th of August. We're playing down there. And I compose all the music for that. And so for that, it's just trumpet, bass, and drum. So I hear all those instruments and I just write something for that. But I've really been expanding my ears so that I can try to write for full orchestra. And it's really interesting because when you just kind of let yourself go and you can start to hear those different sounds, especially because I have such experience being in an orchestra, you can start to hear those sounds and then you're like, oh yeah, the violins do that, oboe does that, you know. And then at some point I'm kind of like, okay, dude, you haven't written anything for the violas, so you got to write something. So there's a little bit of that happens too, you know. But the really great composers, like for instance, like Mozart, supposedly he just heard everything and just wrote it out. Like he wrote out the full score without any mistakes. Just heard everything, next page, just wrote it out. He had it all here. That's fantastic. I am not at that place, not even close to that. But so many composers kind of do it differently to write for full orchestra. Yeah. Good.
I have to ask you, what your favorite piece of music that you've played, let's say with the RPO, let's like do that first because that might be easiest because it's hard to pick your favorites. But what have you played with them that you just like, whenever you play it, you're just like, this is the most amazing. I love this experience.
Well, a couple things. One is I love Shostakovich. I love Shostakovich. That guy had some problems, man. He really had some problems. He had some problems. He was nervous. He was scared for his life. He was trying to write music that on the outside bolstered Russia, and on the inside he was really hating Russia. He did so much, and because he was so angsty and had so many problems, this music just comes out so, you know, just like intense, you know. And I just love his music. And he, I mean, he had beautiful stuff as well, but I just really, really love his music. I have always loved his music. Even in high school, we did a little band arrangement of Shostakovich, Fifth Symphony. And I was just loving that. And even to this day, when Shostakovich is on the bill for RPO, I am just all in. I love Shostakovich. And the other part, too, is like, you know, people love Beethoven, Mozart, blah, you know, that's great. And I love that music. But I'm a trumpet player, right? I'm a trumpet player. So Mozart, basically, we will have a symphony that's, let's say, 35 minutes, 40 minutes for the full symphony. And in that entire symphony, the trumpet will have probably four different notes, four or five different notes. And we play those, I mean, we'll play those notes. I'm playing them to death. I mean, I'm tearing those notes up, right? But it's just dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. Oop, threw that third in there. Dun, 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 dun. Like, so people are like, oh, just Mozart. Just, I'm like, okay, Mozart's great. Yeah, but I'm back there just playing three notes. Shostakovich, he wrote for a trumpet, man. I love Shostakovich. I really do. And then the other thing that I love, and I know in orchestra people get tired of it, especially the brass, because it's kind of, sometimes it gets hard. Man, I just love John Williams, like Star Wars, and I just love that. Like when I was a kid, I was just like, You know, someday I'll be able to play Star Wars, hopefully. I remember that. And now I'm just like, Star Wars, yes, let's go. I love it. So I love playing that kind of stuff. I do.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. No problem at all.
On the movie note, you mentioned Jaws before. Is there another movie you'd love to do?
Well, actually, we did Pirates of the Caribbean. We did that. And I was really excited to do that one, but it didn't have a lot of trumpet stuff in it. I mean, it was fun to kind of be in the feeling of it. You know, it's kind of fun to do that. But that was it was more like lower brass stuff. It wasn't like trumpet stuff. I'm really looking forward to doing Jurassic Park. I really bum 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 da 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 da. See, I think I can play it. You know, that's good stuff right there. Yeah, that is good stuff. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. The other one that I wanted to do was, okay, actually the movie that I really do want to do, and it's really hard, I don't know if it might be too hard for trumpet, is The Incredibles. It's a cartoon. If you ever check that out, when my daughter was smaller, I would play that for her. And I was just like, wow, who is that trumpet player? It's fantastic. I think it was, I think I know who the guy was, Wayne Bergeron. But it's like, yeah, some of those cartoons would be nice to do as well.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
Cartoon would be fun.
Yeah, it'd be a lot of fun. Yeah. But yeah, and I have another piece to play too at some point if we're want to do that. Are there any more questions? I love the Jurassic Park theme. Yeah, me too. Yeah, this is fantastic. I'm so glad that you guys had me here.
Thank you. It's been fantastic. So we really appreciate it.
Yeah, really, really, really great.
We'd love to hear you play.
Sure.
Just please wonderful. Do.
Thank you.
Just wonderful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
This is one. Yeah, great.
So I am going to play some jazz for you for this last one. And this piece I'm going to play for you is West End Blues. This is a song by Louis Armstrong.
Mm.
And the trumpet is... you know, originally the trumpet was just, I kind of like to call it like the world's first cell phone. Because if you wanted to tell somebody across the way to wake up, how are you going to do it? How are you going to tell people to wake up? You know, if you have trumpets, they can play it. It'll be loud enough so it goes across and it wakes them up. So back in the day, what they would do is they had, I guess, one sorry trumpet player had to get up and play the song that woke up the trumpet players, right? And then the trumpet players would come together and play Wake Up for everyone to wake up, right? So that's really what the trumpet kind of started off doing, you know? You know, so that's what it kind of started off with. So Louis Armstrong, when he starts off his piece, he kind of does like a kind of a jazzy trumpet call, kind of like, wake up everybody, you know, we're getting ready to play. And so I really like this one. It's called West End Blues.
Herb, that was a wonderful presentation. And thank you to Jim and to Sue for helping us as well. And if anybody has any more questions or comments, and then I think everybody, Herb has in his background a copy of his city newspaper magazine, and that just came out the August, and he's on the cover. It's a wonderful article too, Herb. So we've got that. There are extra copies in the libraries as well.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. This was really a really pleasure.
I think there's one more question, Sue, too, I think.
I'm sorry.
I think there's one more question, too.
A bunch of people said thank you. And then there's somebody who asked if you mentioned your daughter, and they want to know, they're a little nosy, they want to know if your daughter is a musician also.
Well, she is not a, she's not, I didn't push her to be a musician. Like, my mom always told me that she always bragged. I never had to tell him to practice. Never did. He just practiced on his own. And so I kind of feel like I didn't want to push her to practice. I wanted her to just, it'd be just a natural thing for her. And it wasn't a natural thing for her. But her ear, her musical ear, is fantastic. And in some ways, her ear is better than mine. Quick story. She had to have been, okay, I say she was probably 5, right? Because we moved into the new house, went to kindergarten. Okay, she was like 5. And we would do this whole thing where we would do like 2 books, 2 songs, or 1 book, 1song, like depending on like how late it was. Hey, can I have 2 books, 2 songs? Nope, it's too late. You can have 1 book, 1song. No books, no song today. Write the bed, you know, whatever. So it was time for the song. And I go in and she's like, you know, kind of getting ready to kind of just fade off to sleep. And I start singing this song to her. And she's laying there for a second. And then she said, Dad, stop. I was like, what? She says, that's not the right key. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, like, what am I, chopped liver? I'm a professional musician here. Like, what the heck? Like, and then it was like she was trying to go to sleep and it was just bothering her. Like, she couldn't, you know, she couldn't go to sleep. And then she sang it to me. Dad, it's right here. Do, 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 do. And I'm like, oh my gosh, she's right. She's totally right. So yeah, she's not a musician, but she has a very good musical ear, and we listen to music and stuff a lot. Right now, so she's 17. She's gonna go off to college here soon. So, yeah.
Do you mind me asking where she's going?
Brockport.
Nice. Oh, for psychology? I did that at Brockport. Awesome. She'll be nice and close, so you can see her whenever you want.
Exactly. Far enough away from Dad, you know, to do her thing, but close enough she can, you know, come home on the weekends and have a home-cooked meal or whatever, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, you might have one more question. Sorry, going down to the chat. Oh, other people just saying how much they've enjoyed this. I have to tell you that I have a little secret crush on you. And every time I would go to the RPO, I would always look for you. And you're easy to find for a few different reasons. But mainly I would always look for your hair because your hair, everybody else has like, yeah, I would always look for your hair in the crowd. It was really easy to find you quickly. And, you know, I always, it's been really a pleasure for me to get to hear you talk because, you know, go to the concerts and the conductor is the only one who ever really says anything. And so you never get to really hear from you musicians. And I've been going since I was a little girl with my parents. And some of these musicians have been in the RPO for a really long time. Yeah. And I remember them from like my whole life. They've been there and I've always wanted to hear their voices. So I'm really excited that we got to hear yours.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. There's a guy who, a tuba player who is no longer in the orchestra. And he became good friends with people that came to concerts. And they ended up telling him that, like, they would go to concerts so much, and they used to bring binoculars, that they knew he had three pairs of black shoes. Like, they would go down on his shoes. And so they were like, which shoes is Cherry going to wear today? Is he going to wear the boots or is he going to? And he said he was like blown away by that. Like, wow. But yeah, but you know, it's like, you don't, you know, people don't really get to talk to us much, you know, and that's part of, I think, what needs to change too in the orchestra, just to make it more accessible and, you know, people just come out and talk and stuff. So, yeah.
Yeah. No, I think people really are interested in, and talking to the people that they watch all the time. Are you excited about your new musical director there?
Yeah. Andreas Delfs. He you know, he brings kind of a looking back and a looking forward. He knows how to, you know, he's been around the block, so he knows how to really get in there and make the orchestra work. And get us tightened up, and at the same time looking forward at new works and new composers and stuff like that. So I'm really looking forward to working with him.
Well, we're excited. We're hoping we're all going to be able to come back in person a little bit more. That's for sure.
We're working on that. Yes, we are. Eastman is right now. They're saying Eastman is going to be open for business, you know, probably like a vaccine card you'll need to show or something like that. But they said they're going to be open, and we're really hoping for that to happen.
Fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thanks again. This was excellent. So
thank you, Herb.